a UN report, East Africa has seen a threefold increase in elephant poaching since 2006.
2012, we lost 384. And right now, as we speak, we have lost about 270.
Ivory tusks such as this obviously represent dead elephants, and a majority of which have died grisly deaths in the hands of poachers.
We have succeeded in seizing 13 tons of ivory at the port of Mombasa because we are working in close collaboration, Kenya Wildlife Service, Kenya Police, Kenya Airports Authority, and Kenya Revenue Authority.
Why should Kenyans care? Westgate has happened, and that has shown you, because Al-Shabaab are being funded by ivory.
The war on poaching must be fought on every front and by all Kenyans.
Hi, welcome to Project Green. I'm at Save the Elephants and I'm here to meet Dr. Ian Hamilton, one of the foremost authorities in the African elephant conservation circles. Come on.
Ian.
Yeah, nice seat.
Thank you.
This crisis now is worse in one way, that there are fewer elephants, but the demand for ivory is as high or higher than it's ever been. And we have a new gigantic source of that demand in the Far East. And that is what is driving the killing. And most of the ivory is leaving not as artifacts within people's luggage, it's going out in containers. And unfortunately, that's driven by a huge level of demand.
In Asia, ivory carvings are a symbol of luxury for many. A growing Asian middle class means a huge number of the population can easily afford ivory products. An international ivory trade ban was effected by CITES in 1989, but in 1997 and in 2007, this regulation was loosened to allow several African countries to sell their ivory stockpiles to China and Japan. This decision had a downside effect as demand for ivory has not come down since.
The ban applies to the elephants in the African range, especially because in Asia their populations are minimal and most of them have legal sale.
This trade in ivory, especially in the Asian countries, has not been well regulated. And it is hard to tell between legal and illegal ivory in the Asian markets. And as a result, poaching has become a high-stakes game and ivory the next conflict resource.
Wherever there is an elephant, there is a poacher. And that has compounded our problem because we have to spread ourselves thin, try to ensure the safety of elephants, even in areas where previously there were no poachers.
Samburu, a land of wild beauty and extreme contrasts. Along with the Tsavo National Park, the Samburu Laikipia ecosystem has seen a spate of elephant killings in the recent years.
Hi. Good, how are you?
Good to see you. Yeah, that's just like this part.
As of June 2013, about 50 elephants were illegally killed in the Ewaso ecosystem. 2012 is still the worst year yet for the elephants. A staggering 217 of them were illegally killed in the ecosystem, which includes the Samburu and Laikipia areas.
By the bullets. As you can see, they put the bullets through. Yes. So they put the bullets through that collar and it was destroyed. This particular collar that I'm holding here, you can see it has a lot of blood stain. And this was a female called Bonsai and she was all over the news in the world. This poaching was so bad that it was, you can see all that. These are all bullet holes.
How much does it eat in a day?
About 300 kilos.
Three who?
300 kilos.
300 kilos
mm-hmm.
a day.
Yes, a mature elephant. You see the dynamics of the groups changing, and you just find in some groups more juveniles than the adults, and then the groups slowly disintegrate because if you don't have a matriarch or you don't have the leader, the old female that actually puts the group together, then it's a big problem to the herd. And the group kind of breaks into small pieces. Elephants are very social animals, and they do actually depend so much on each other. And if you actually kill, or if the big ones disappear, the young ones are going to have a lot of trouble in their life. The trouble here is they don't know where to go, they don't know where the food is, they don't know the safe places, they can't really leave the packs, they get so confused. So you really need the old ones to actually take them to safe havens.
Okay, and here is a male, and it's... This is amazing. Now, the Samburu have coexisted with wildlife for centuries, and I'm here in one of the manyatas to talk to an elder who will tell me more about the value they placed on wildlife.
What do you think? I'm not one of the mother, they never have money. They need to make a shirini. They need to make a shirini.
But now, all that is changing in the face of poverty and various other factors such as climate change, population growth, and the proliferation of illegal arms, especially in the northern frontier districts. Kuyasu is a changed man. But a few years back, he plied the illicit ivory trade in search of his daily bread. Although Kuyasu has turned a new leaf, several others have fallen for the lure of rewards offered by well-resourced criminal poaching gangs looking to recruit locals with a good knowledge of the terrain and wildlife.
So now we've heard of the local, national and international factors that drive poaching. The key takeout is that global demand for ivory must be brought down. Let's join Dan and his panel as they take on this on Green Talk next.
Wildlife crimes nowadays rank among the top five most lucrative illicit activities in the world. There's clearly urgent need to review our strategies in solving this problem. And in studio today, to talk about this, please welcome Samar Ntalamia, Program Manager, Big Life Foundation, Kenya, and Paul Muya, the Deputy Spokesperson from the Kenya Wildlife Service, KWS. Gentlemen, welcome to Green Talk. All right, before we get into the integrities of what the Kenya Wildlife Service is doing in terms of, you know, dealing with poaching, Ntalamia, you know, the communities traditionally have had ways of, you know, handling this issue of poaching, but currently I think there's the perception that they have been left out in the conservation efforts. Why do you think this is happening?
For the Maasai, we've been lucky because there are cultural mechanisms in place to enable people to live with the wildlife. Like it was like a sin to go out and kill an animal unnecessarily. It was also a taboo to kill wildlife and eat its meat. Part of the problem is the coming in of the authorities, maybe the KWS, and saying the wildlife belongs to the government. And because they endanger people's lives and destroy people's livelihoods, people tend to view wildlife as an enemy. And what do you do with an enemy? You try to wipe it out.
Okay, so community involvement, of course, paramount importance.
Certainly, it is.
But how do we stop this from happening? How can we stop the trade?
We've had initiatives whereby we've involved celebrities to create awareness in the Far East, especially in Taiwan, China, to tell people, to create awareness and education that when you buy a piece of tusk, know that it's an elephant that was brutally killed and the tusk hiked off from the face, to try and bring a mindset change.
Okay, coming to you, Paul, poachers now have become extremely sophisticated. Extremely organized. They're using state-of-the-art equipment. They're using stealth helicopters, night vision, long-range rifles. Do you feel that the Kenya Wildlife Service is going to a gunfight with a stick?
Not at all. There is a program that we're already working on, and it has been in progress, called Force Modernization. And this program has to do with how do we ensure that we train our rangers so that they have the cutting edge training in terms of ensuring that we combat poaching heads on. We are already working with the government. They have given indication that they will allow us to employ about 1,000 rangers. And before we do that, recently they gave us about 80 or so men from the various agencies. I'm aware that they are already working with us, what we are calling anti-poaching crack unit, that comprises of ourselves, and Kenya police, as well as the administration police, so that we are able to beef up security. Okay. Other than that, we are looking at how do we even integrate technology.
All right.
In ensuring that we dominate.
Just from the back of what you're talking about, when you're talking about rangers in Talamia, you know, you're on the ground, and these proposals or these things that Paul is saying, do you find that they will be effective, and do you think they'll actually work?
Apart from a well-equipped and trained military unit to fight poachers, the future of wildlife is inevitably, inextricably intertwined with the communities that live with the wildlife. So it's a multifaceted problem, but the key things are a well-trained unit as well as a very strong community involvement. Big Life Kenya has about 315 community game rangers covering over 2 million plus acres of ecosystem. Yeah. We also have a presence in northern Tanzania. And over time, we've really come to learn that apart from having vehicles, having all other state-of-the-art equipment and even weapons, without community involvement, yes, you know, we can't win this war.
Paul, I don't know, as we conclude, I don't know whether you have other ideas of more incentives that can be given to communities to be part of this, you know, massive fight that we're trying to do. Because I think also there's a sense of patriotism that comes with conservation of wildlife. How do you make people become more aware and more willing to be part of the big fight?
Most of the rangers that are working within the communities, especially the community rangers in this case, are more or less people who are the locals. You see, they are the people the communities nominate. Secondly, we are looking at how do we ensure that the enterprises that are wildlife-based, wildlife-related, have a seed capital to ensure that it is more capital intensive, more able to therefore provide incentive, and more able to attract investment. And Kenya Wildlife Service is already providing that seed capital through our partnership with communities, through partnership with other agencies that are working within various communities, so that within Amboseli, for instance, where my friends work, already his institution is a partner with the Kenya Wildlife Service. It is also the same replicated elsewhere in Samburu, in Mara, in the western part of the country, to ensure that communities everywhere within this republic have programs that are more or less wildlife related, and they are in themselves an enterprise.
Gentlemen, I wish you all the best in this fight, and I think it's also the responsibility of every Kenyan to be part of this fight against poaching. Thank you, gentlemen, for being on Green Talk today.
Thank you.
Coming up next, we showcase our Green Heroes of the Week, right after the break.
My name is Jim Nyamu. I'm currently directing Elephant Labor Center. I am a research scientist with 16 years experience, having worked in Kenya Wildlife Service and international organization, and looking at the elephant issues. For the last 1 year, I've been working in this country and outside the country, raising awareness on poaching and how can community begin benefiting and participating in wildlife conservation in Kenya. At the moment, this country is losing nearly 3 elephants per day. Comparing with the population of the 26,600 elephants, it looks like in the next maybe less than 10 years, we'll have no elephants.
Yeah.
Kenya, 2011, we had that 5,000 elephants. Today, that means the last year, 2013 status, we have 26,000. That means for the last 3 years, we've lost quite almost 10,000 elephants. When I started working out here in 1919, we had close to 9,000 elephants. Now, going back to how many elephants do we have, 2,700, it would touch communities. For sure, we have killed all these elephants. So you would see people now start now sympathizing with the situation. I reached a point that I said, enough is enough. I participate in community projects where community feels they're not part of what is happening. So I decided, let me just use what I have, my feet and my mouth, to work and encourage communities. I have seen a lot of efforts that have started, that have borne fruit since I started walking. I remember my first walk in March, in February 9th last year, from Mombasa to Nairobi. And the second one, which I started in Masai Mara, we've seen the penalties have increased from 1 year to now life in prison, and from 40,000 shillings fine to 20 million. I've also seen my reason to work in the US. I had a chance to have a meeting with the ICCO and provoked them to ban the 6.6 tons of ivory. I have seen that provoked China, that they also banned 6.1 tons.
Conservation in Kenya, for them that have been, you know, understanding the conservation dynamic.
Where I'm working in the US is because I learned America, they are the second leading consumer of ivory. I'm also planning to do a work in China as well.
Maria Vijana, Kusawa. Yes. Good. Kulingana na vile tunapata ni kwamba ndovu wanauawa siku na mchana. Hapa itakuwa ni jukumu letu sisi kama wananchi wa Kenya, haswa sisi vijana wadogo. Hawa wanyama wakiangamia, sisi ndio tutakuwa wa kwanza, you know, kukosa riziki yetu. Ni sawa sawa. Kwa hivyo naomba tafadhali mnisaidie.
One thing this country has to change for this poaching to stop. We have to change our attitude. We've been blaming Chinese for long. If we begin saying we are the people who are killing elephants, because for sure we are the people who are killing this, we change our attitude. Then the other thing is, KWS need support. They have less than 2,000 armed raiders, so we need to support them. In Kenya, I've done 2,500 kilometers. In the US, I walked 560 miles last year. And this year, I plan to walk 3,000 kilometers from Kampala, Dar es Salaam, Nairobi. I want to leave just a simple legacy that in my time, I was able to pass the message of conserving this wildlife.
There has been a recent surge, starting in about 2009, of ivory poaching. It is having a devastating effect on elephants, both in Kenya and across Africa. In Kenya, we're on the edge of a big battle, and the forces that protect, like the Kenya Wildlife Service and the private community nature conservancies, they're being stretched to the limit to protect elephants and the other animals. If nothing is done to stem the tide, we can look forward to elephants being reduced to very low numbers. We could see the disappearance of those magnificent herds on which our tourism depends. Ordinary Kenyans need to be aware of their heritage, number one. The more they can go and see it for themselves, the better. And then the people of this country can come together to help in a movement to insist that the laws for protecting wildlife are strong, to support the Kenya Wildlife Service with information. I think it all comes from both enjoying the animals and leading to action, to being aware that this is a priceless heritage. Ultimately, we need to save the elephants and protect our heritage.
Mimi naitwa Dennis Kiprotich. kutoka Mount Elgon. Sasa mimi naweza uliza serikali swali moja tu. Tunaambiwa tuchunge hawa ndovu. Lakini sasa huyo ndovu hata sisi huyo ndovu hakuna chenye yeye anaweza tusaidia sisi wenyewe. Sasa kuna maneno ile tunaambiwa tuchunge, sasa si atujui juu hawatusaidii kitu. Sasa sijui tutaichunga kinamna gani.
Kenyans might know that elephants are dying, but why is that important? If I sit in a matatu every day, and at one point elephants are going to disappear from the face of Kenya, then one person in that matatu may lose their job, because 11% of jobs come from tourism. So you might not think you're affected, but you're actually very much affected.
These magnificent beasts behind me are facing perhaps one of their most severe and devastating poaching crises in decades. And we cannot sit idly by and do nothing as they continue to sink down the precipice of extinction. What are you going to do to save the African elephant? See you next week.
Okay, and here is a male, and it's... Dude, how do you expect me to be so calm when here it is?
No,
in the name of Jesus.
It's okay.
Look, guys, how can you tell me to say something and here is a charging bull?
That's a kid, that's like a calf.
Okay, I'll say something later. Look at this, it's an interesting picture of a herd of elephants mourning their dead. I mean, it says here, when elephants find dead bodies of other elephants, they caress their bodies and sometimes carry them away. It seems like that's what's happening here.
This is the skull. This was a big guy called Pretty Boom Boom. It was a big bull. He was about 50 years old.